Hi, I'm Beth Quinn from NCWIT. In this video, we're going to explore some ways that you can build a more inclusive student community in your computing program. That is, how can you create a climate where all students are welcome, supported, and are able to do their best work? The module on retaining students in computing, Module 4, is structured around the NCWIT Engagement Practices Framework, which consists of 11 practices. These are all great teaching practices, but they're grouped under three principles that speak to how they can also help to retain students who are underrepresented in computing. The first principle, build student confidence and professional identity, is covered in section 2 of this module. And the principle, make it matter, is covered in the third section. In this presentation, let's focus on the last principle, grow an inclusive student community to foster belonging. Students are more likely to persist when they have a community related to their academic pursuits. The research is pretty clear on this. So consider this. Computing can pose some challenges to having a sense of community or a sense of belonging because the demographics are pretty skewed. Walk into most introductory computing courses and you're likely to see 70 to 90% men, and many of these men will be white or Asian. Now, granted, being part of a demographic majority doesn't necessarily translate into community. It's not automatic, but it does mean that you're a step closer to being able to make connections than someone who isn't part of that majority. So, helping students make connections and helping them learn to work well together is how faculty and staff can foster inclusive community and increase student retention. And as any experienced teacher will tell you, a class is only partially about what the instructor is doing and saying, and a student's experience in a program goes way beyond just what happens in their classes. Their interaction with other students is super important. So let's look at this graphically. If you did, say, a social network diagram of the students in your program, what would it look like? In this diagram, the blue circles are individual students and the lines are the connections between them. Ideally, we'd also diagram the quality and nature of the connection, but let's just keep it simple. So, do students feel like they belong? Are they comfortable asking questions in front of other students? And do students support each other's success, or do they tear each other down? Can they get help from other students if they need it? Or are many students isolated? Even worse, are some harassing others, and do some students have to avoid others or even avoid class or labs because of it? So, what can you do? The first obvious thing you can do is create a Women in Computing group to help create some connections among the women in your program. These groups can be a great source of support, friendships, and networking. And similarly, you can support the creation of student groups for racial and ethnic minorities that are appropriate for your context, say a chapter of the National Society of Black Engineers. Both of these approaches can provide a safe and productive space for students who are from groups that are underrepresented in computing. But these groups also have some downsides. First, they're only going to work for students who are able to take advantage of them. They are extracurricular after all. So students who are parents, have difficult commutes, or complicated work schedules just aren't going to be able to benefit. And also, not all students are inclined to join an extracurricular group, even if they have the time. Second, they can potentially isolate women and minority students, and alone, they can do little to improve the overall climate of the program. Students of all genders and communities need to learn to work well together, and all students need to have access to these opportunities. Because of this, often the best way to facilitate inclusive student community is in the classroom. All students can participate and instructors are present to help mentor, structure, and guide the interactions. There are two main ways. First, you can use kind of a collaborative activities that have the sole purpose of just having students interact. So, for example, using an icebreaker at the beginning of a course. Or you can use and integrate into the course well-structured collaborative learning. So these are activities where the goal is for the students to focus on learning together. For the remainder of this video, I'd like to focus on this latter type of or set of techniques. So let's quickly review four possible techniques that you might implement, organized from the least structured and easiest to implement to some more complex but incredibly powerful ones. These are all great ways for students to learn, but for our purposes, we're going to focus on how, if they're done thoughtfully, they can help build an inclusive student culture and help retain students in computing. So first, in Think, Pair, Share, you provide students with a relatively open-ended problem. They then spend a few minutes working on it alone. This is an important step because it provides students who need to think before talking a bit more space to do that. Then you have the students pair up at the most work in groups of three. It's important to keep the groups small to allow all students to speak. The students then spend some time working on the problem together, and then finally the instructor brings the class back together, and as a class, you discuss their solutions and interpretations. This is an incredibly versatile technique. It can be implemented in any kind of classroom, from a seminar to a large lecture hall, and for just a couple of minutes or for much longer. Ideally, since this is a relatively unstructured technique, I'd recommend only using it for smaller periods of time and for smaller problems. While Think, Pair, Share is used across the disciplines, pair programming is specific to computer science, but it's also a relatively easy technique to implement. Briefly, this technique is where pairs of students program together on one computer. One person, called the driver, controls the keyboard. The other is the navigator. I'll leave explaining the specifics to Colleen Lewis in her great video on the topic, which is the next item in this module. But what I want to underscore here is that pair programming is not difficult to implement, but you really need to stick to the structure, and it's something that you won't want to ask students to do for homework, so it's best done in a club or a lab so you're able to monitor it. The final two are peer instruction and process-oriented guided inquiry learning, or POGL. I can't go into any depth on either of these techniques right now since they're fairly complex and content-specific, but they have some things in common that I'd like to highlight. First, both have students work in groups on very well-structured problems. Often, specific roles are assigned to students, and as with pair programming, students rotate through these roles. With all of these techniques, it's important to stick to the structure and make sure that students understand why you're having them do these activities this way. You can find links to more information on both of these techniques in the additional resources section of this module. The bottom line for all of these techniques is that when they're implemented well, they can have a really powerful effect on the student culture in your program. Since they're done in the classroom, they benefit all students, not just those who are able to participate in extracurricular activities. And instructors can also come to know the students better by observing their interactions and just listening to what they have to say. So why all the emphasis on well-structured? I mean, students working in groups, what could possibly go wrong? For collaborative learning to positively impact student community, students need to have a good experience. There's nothing more frustrating, demotivating, and alienating than being forced to work with someone and it's not going well. But conversely, there's nothing like working successfully with someone on a project to help you, one, get to know that other person, and two, to build a real connection. So let's run through a few of the ways that group work can go off the rails and not only interfere with learning, but damage motivation and belonging rather than build it. My intention is not to scare you off from implementing collaborative learning, but we need to be real. And as with any failure model, it will get you thinking about how to do it better. So what are some worst case scenarios for collaborative learning? So why can't you just throw students into groups, give them a project, and let them work it out? First, some individuals may dominate the conversations and the work, while others may just opt out and retreat. Both behaviors are problematic for learning, the growth of student relationships, and a sense of belonging. Second, left alone, groups may fall into bad communication practices, creating unnecessary friction and conflict in the group. What does this look like? Interrupting, belittling, ignoring, or stealing contributions, just to name a few. Granted, no group work will be without conflict. We just want to minimize the unproductive and unnecessary stuff. Third, not being professional. For example, letting personal stuff get in the way of the work. This is a skill that students really need to practice if they're going to be successful in the workplace, and structured group work helps teach some of these skills. And finally, left on their own with little structure provides space for sexist and racist patterns to emerge. This may include the practice of divvying up tasks in stereotypical ways, for example, having the women take the notes and do the graphics work while the men do the technical work, which grows rather than diminishes the experience gap. It may also take the form of the contributions of women and racial minorities being diminished or ignored. So, without structure and monitoring, group work can end up being detrimental to student culture and a sense of belonging for some students. So, structuring the collaborative learning process is like putting training wheels on. The structure bounds what's possible, focuses the group, and makes roles and behavioral expectations explicit. These are excellent things to do in intercourses where you really shouldn't expect students to know how to work on computing tasks together. Having clear roles and tasks and guidelines and training on effective communication allows students to practice collaborating in a safer environment. Along the way, they can get to know each other better. And by doing some switching up of the groups, students can start to build a network of people they know and can depend on. In conclusion, well-structured collaborative learning techniques can be a great way to build an inclusive and vibrant student community. In this video, we've covered a few ways that you can help build a more inclusive student community in your computing program. These include supporting the creation of student groups, such as a Women in Computing chapter or a chapter of the National Society of Black Engineers. Foster informal student interactions by using icebreakers, for example, at the beginning of course. The Engage CSEDU collection has a couple great ones you could use. And finally, use well-structured collaborative learning in courses, especially in the introductory ones. I'm Beth Quinn from NCWIT. I hope this introduction to techniques for building an inclusive student community has been helpful.